2022 was a big year for anime. We had some of the most anticipated adaptations, sequels, and finales, a handful of unique originals, and a trend of pseudo-musicals and some ambitious anisong collaborations. Today, in celebration of the anime of 2022, and because it's better late than ever, I wanted to do a fun little video talking about my personal 10 favorite anime of the year. JoJo's Bizarre Adventure Stone Ocean, Parts 2 through 3. Stone Ocean, which is the sixth part of JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, might not be the best part of JoJo. The main villain's motives are a bit vague, some of the stand powers get kinda convoluted, the ending is definitely something, and the main cast doesn't have quite the same level of group chemistry as the main casts of Golden Wind or Stardust Crusaders. But Stone Ocean is still pretty cool because it deals with the very first, and so far only, female protagonist. Jolene Kujo, the teenage daughter of Jotaro, along with her band of prison mates, goes after the evil Poochie in order to save her father and stop Poochie from reaching his ultimate goal of achieving heaven. Whatever that means. Jolene absolutely carries the show with her satisfying character transformation from whiny teenager to a fearless warrior. Plus, we get some of the most hilariously bizarre fights the series has seen so far, with villains like Yo-Yo Ma, Jailhouse Rock, and Bohemian Rhapsody being some of my favorites. I always love watching JoJo, and despite Stone Ocean's hype, draining release schedule on Netflix, it was still a great time. Encouragement of Climb, or Yama no Susume, Next Summit. I love slice of life anime. Chihaya Furu and Sound Euphonium are some of my favorite pieces of media just ever. But something many of my favorite slices of life have in common is a heightened sense of drama and or major character development. Two things the iyashikei, or healing, subgenre of slice of life is not exactly known for. A year ago when I watched the first season of Yama no Susume, a very simple anime about some girls who like to hike mountains together, I was pleasantly entertained, but truthfully a bit bored. This fourth season, however, Yama no Susume Next Summit, which conveniently recaps the first three seasons in its opening episodes, hit me differently. Now I get the appeal. It's charming, it's cozy, and it's subtly inspirational. The character development is simple and the drama is light, but it's definitely there. The visuals, particularly the backgrounds, are beautiful. As something wholesome to watch casually once a week, it's perfect. And now I want to go hiking. Komi Can't Communicate, Part 2. The first part of Komi Can't Communicate's anime adaptation was one of my favorites of 2021, and the series returned last year with a part 2 of the comedic and usually wholesome adventures of a girl with social anxiety and selective mutism trying her best to make new friends. And as someone with social anxiety, I will always appreciate this show for offering a uniquely positive perspective on it. Komi never comes off as cringy or pathetic, and I always want to root for her. I love this show very much, and although Part 2's production values dropped a bit compared to Part 1, say for a few scenes, it's still the same very, very good show. Komi-san wa Komi-shou desu. Cyberpunk Edgerunners. Never doubt Studio Trigger and director Hiroyuki Imaishi. Film and TV adaptations of video games have rarely worked in the past, and I went into this show with the same trepidation. I had some hope for the team behind it, but I was worried we were going to get a Cyberpunk 2077 vanity project serviced by Studio Trigger, rather than a true Studio Trigger show based on Cyberpunk. Thankfully though, we got the latter. In this prequel to the aptly named video game, we follow one David Martinez, a down-on-his-luck teen whose life is turned upside down when he gets access to superhuman cyber technology and joins a group of mercenaries. As big and bombastic, colorful and creative, and narratively strong as any of Imaishi's previous projects have been, Cyberpunk Edgerunners is an anime more than worthy of the pedigree of the team behind it, while pushing them to new levels of maturity and expression. It's not the most original story they've worked on, to be fair, but it's told very well, and it's a big win for the viability of video game adaptations in general. Vampire in the Garden. While Edgerunners broke out this year with lots of buzz, another Netflix miniseries seems to have flown under the radar. Vampire in the Garden was produced by the very versatile and reliable Studio Wit, with the recognizable Tetsuya Nishio, who worked on Naruto and Jinro, doing the character designs. It's a very short, 5-episode series about a world where humans and vampires are at war, and in it, a human girl and a vampire woman go on a road trip together to find peace. The world building is deep, atmospheric, and immersive, and the adventure that the two main characters go on is at times cozy and heartwarming, and other times perilous and full of drama and tragedy. It was definitely one of the most exciting shows of the year for me. Okay, top 5. Akiba Maid War. Akiba Maid War was one of my biggest surprises of 2022. Its weird and mysterious marketing campaign only made it clear that it was going to be about maid cafes in Akihabara, but with some kind of adult twist. Akiba Maid War very easily could have been a trashy show that relied on some cheap gimmick, but thankfully that's not what it was. The show is based on one singular premise: what if maids were Yakuza? And it finds a way to continue to repeat and riff on and add to that one joke in surprising ways with each and every episode. In this world, maids are both cute and badass at the same time. On top of that, it also tells a great coming-of-age story of a young, naive maid in way over her head, and an older maid trying to find her place in the present while being forced to confront her dark past. Akiba Maid War is constantly inventive and hilarious. It's one of the few standout original anime of the year, and it boasts the consistently great production quality of Studio PA Works. Chainsaw Man. Anyone who knows me well knows that for the past year and a half, I've been obsessed with Chainsaw Man, the story of a boy who becomes a chainsaw man and gets recruited to fight monsters. I love the manga to death, and I've read everything the author Tatsuki Fujimoto has published. Chainsaw Man was by leaps and bounds my most anticipated anime in years. So why is it in fourth place here? Okay, two reasons. First, the anime only adapts the first 38 chapters of the manga, which I consider the weaker part. Make no mistake, this part of the story is not bad by any means, it's good, but it's not the part that gets me really excited. That'll be next season. The second reason this show isn't higher on my list is that I just didn't jive 100% with all the choices made in the adaptation. That said, this show is very difficult for me to complain about considering how absolutely gorgeous it is to look at for the most part. The drawings are detailed, the animation is nuanced and exceptional, the sound design is incredible, and the storyboarding is just stunning. It's clear that lots of love, dedication, and talent went into the making of this show. It's one of the most ambitious TV anime productions I've ever seen. I mean, the fact that they put together 12 different ending sequences with 12 different songs by 12 different musicians with 12 different animations to accompany them is already proof enough. But as an admittedly obsessive fan of the manga, I think I found myself distracted by the changes, additions, and subtractions the adaptation made more than I found myself really enjoying the anime for what it was. The anime is more grounded, it's more cinematic, more atmospheric, and in some ways more sentimental than the manga is, for better or for worse. And I guess what I mean by that is the anime generally feels more conventional than the manga, which is just filled with Fujimoto's unique idiosyncrasies as a manga artist and writer. And I realize some people might not agree with this criticism, and honestly I feel a little conflicted about it myself. Without a doubt, the adaptation of Chainsaw Man is a different beast than the source material, but really, what great adaptation isn't? It wouldn't be on this list if I didn't love it, and maybe as time passes I'll learn to love it even more alongside the manga. But for now, there were a few other shows that I liked better this year. Attack on Titan, the final season, part 2. Every time I revisit Attack on Titan, I'm always impressed how it turned from a simple dark fantasy thing about giant, naked, hungry people into a narratively rich and morally complex political war drama with giant, hungry, naked people. This core dials up the twists and the complexity to another degree while also showing off Studio MAPPA's improved production on both their 2D end and their 3D CG end, for the most part. It's so satisfying seeing all the plot threads coming together and overlapping and twisting together, and it truly feels like the end is near. The Tatami Time Machine Blues. Not many people saw the Tatami Time Machine Blues because Disney very quietly licensed it, very quietly put it on the schedule to be released on Disney Plus, then very quietly took it off the Disney Plus schedule, and very quietly put it up on Hulu without so much as a single promotional tweet. Tatami Time Machine Blues is a standalone sequel to one of the most unique anime franchises from the 2010s, starting with the TV series, The Tatami Galaxy, in 2010, following a university freshman who finds himself stuck in a Groundhog Day-style time loop and uses the opportunity to try out every on-campus club he can to find his ideal life path. Then it was followed up by the film Night is Short, Walk on Girl in 2017, which follows a female college sophomore's crazy, quirky, drink-filled night adventure through Kyoto. Then we have 2022's Tatami Time Machine Blues, which feels like just an extended, extra fun episode of the 2010 series. On a hot summer day, an eclectic group of college kids in the film club discover a time machine in the apartment where they're shooting their newest independent movie. They decide to use it to return to the previous day when their air conditioner wasn't broken. If you like Back to the Future, it's basically a quirky, small-scale anime version of that with some of the most fun animation you'll see anywhere. The way it sets up things without you noticing and pays them off in surprising ways as the time travel shenanigans ensue is so satisfying and funny, and the ending is a sweetly romantic payoff. Every single episode of this show is simply delightful. Now, before we get to my number one show of the year, I want to shout out some honorable mentions. These shows didn't quite make the list, but I still enjoyed them quite a bit. Spy Family, Call of the Night, Licorice Recoil, Do It Yourself, and Mob Psycho 103. Bocchi the Rock. It feels almost cliche at this point to name Bocchi the Rock my favorite anime of the year, when it seems to be topping a lot of other people's lists too, but I suppose that just shows its impact on audiences. Bocchi the Rock is undoubtedly one of, if not my absolute favorite anime experience of 2022. It tells the comedic story of a young solo guitarist named Bocchi with seriously severe social anxiety. One day, she is asked to join a fledgling high school rock band as their lead guitarist, and we watch as their lives change forever. I went into this anime with zero expectations and came out being surprised, delighted, and tickled at almost every turn. In a lot of ways, this is my ideal comedy-leaning slice-of-life anime that's one part a heartfelt coming-of-age story about overcoming social anxiety and discovering your dreams, one part a detailed look at the minutiae of young band life, and one part a genuinely laugh-out-loud, hilarious comedy with some of the most inventive visual gags that give even Kaguya-sama a run for its money. It's also got me itching to pick up the guitar for the first time since middle school. Bocchi the Rock is not a show for everyone, but I adore it, and that's why it's here as my number one favorite anime of 2022. Thanks so much for watching and listening. Let me know what your favorite anime of 2022 were down in the comments, and have an awesome 2023.